So if you're a Zelda fan, like myself, you're probably very excited for the newest Zelda game, or possibly interested at the very least, as we are finally getting a deep dive into the world of Breath of the Wild from 100 years ago. Not only does this game look super interesting in its own lights, but a project like this is going to be crucial in explaining the story of the Great Calamity and the deep interactions between the champions and other characters, and ultimately flesh out the lore of the newly established Breath of the Wild trilogy. And just by looking really closely at the trailer, there are tons of little secrets and allusions that tell a much greater story about what's to come in this game and for the series. So I thought for today, I would swiftly yet thoroughly break down 5 of the most interesting ones that will help make sense of what's all to come. So with that said, number 1, the chronology. Although this game is set to take place during the Great Calamity, not everything shown here seems to line up with that assumption, as we can see Link wearing the knight's armor and broadsword instead of the champion's tunic and master sword. It wouldn't make sense for his character to downgrade his gear in the midst of such a huge battle, so these events are likely to take place before even all of Breath of the Wild's memories, as he was just a Hyrulean knight before becoming an appointed champion by the kingdom. This is further proved by the shots where Link and Revali duel, where we can see that Revali is also missing his blue champion sash just like Link, meaning that there will be plenty of content and even cutscenes that date before the memories and the big war. Number 2, a late corruption. In Breath of the Wild, the events of the Great Calamity are explained in a way that make them feel so fast. Calamity Ganon is seen shooting out of the castle, followed directly by a shot of Malice corrupting all the guardians and divine beasts, which instantly brings the world to its demise. But the actual spacing between these events seems to be a bit elongated, because in the trailer, we can clearly see Divine Beast Varudania in its blue, uncorrupted state, and we even see a dormant, non-power guardian in the battleground of the Akala Citadel, meaning that the initial awakening of Calamity Ganon did not corrupt everything. Instead, it's heavily assumed that many great battles in this war were initially won by Hyrule with victory soon at hand, and Ganon's really cunning move of corrupting the beast and sending out the Pillar Guardians wasn't done until the champions and their beasts were about to launch their final attack. The shot that we see of Link and Zelda getting startled by a single guardian laser helps prove this, as this guardian was likely a surprise one that came out of one of the pillars, which were soon to swarm the city of Hyrule and kill all the important figures like the king. This is likely around the same time that the champions were seen being defeated by the Blights, and possibly where Link was being attacked by a figure wielding a thunder-like weapon, but the exact details on who or what this figure is are clearly unknown. Number 3, a familiar face. Although most characters during the Great Calamity War either die out or simply don't age by the events of Breath of the Wild, the one character we see several times within this trailer that is much different is Impa, who is currently a 20-year-old woman in comparison to the 120-year-old version we see in the future. Across the past installments, the title of Impa is usually given to the Sheikah woman who serves as Zelda's personal protector and guardian, which could have been a role in this game before Link became champion and the appointed knight, as he is still donning his knight's armor in this clip. However, if we look really close at the one fast-moving shot later in the trailer, we can pause this frame to yet again see Impa with Zelda and Link, but this time while he is wearing his champion's armor, potentially proving that Impa decided to team up with them and fight as a trio. Because hell, given her closeness to the Sheikah tech explained by the lore, it's likely that her and her sister could have been the ones responsible for creating this mini guardian robot we see on the box art, but only time will tell what this thing is really meant to be. Number 4, established structures. The world of Breath of the Wild is home to many monster camps across the land, but for the longest time, it has been unknown if these only spring up before the war, during it, or afterwards. But in the trailer, we can clearly see Link in his pre-champion state fighting a group of Bokoblins near one, and we even see the tip of another one at the start of the shot with Divine Beast Varudania, proving that monsters were spawning in large enough quantities before the war and fortifying their land. This would line up with the fact that a huge wave of enemies were able to rush the castle before the war and before the champions were established, and even explain the surge of monsters that were mentioned in Breath of the Wild Memory 8. On a gameplay level, it's likely that these forts will serve as enemy keeps similar to the first Hyrule Warriors games, and taking them down will be key to winning particular battles, as we can see Link blowing one up in the trailer and watch it crumbling down, which really intrigues me to see how this game will play out in that factor. Which leads us into number 5, breaking the canon. When it comes to the gameplay itself, This is where I feel the game may break away from the actual canon of Breath of the Wild story. Although the Zelda team specifically stated that they worked with the Hyrule Warriors team through every step of the creation process, there are a lot of gameplay elements that directly contradict the canonicity of Breath of the Wild. A big one being all the runes shown off in the trailer, as Breath of the Wild implies that these weren't developed by Pyra until after the Great War. And even the ancient arrow Link uses in the screenshots, which weren't even developed by Robbie until much later as well. A possible loophole they could use to get around this to make a canon is by saying that these technologies were lost after the Calamity War, but redeveloped by these characters afterwards. Ancient arrows may have just been in low supply, and the Sheikah Slate could have been damaged and lost those runes, similar to how the Camera Rune was damaged at the start of Breath of the Wild. But even so, it doesn't quite explain how Zelda is able to pull off crazy stunts like throwing a flurry of bombs, or how Link was able to pull one out of thin air without even a Sheikah Slate, which are more things that could question the canonicity. But with this game being a different type of Zelda experience, you know, a hack and slash and all, I feel that it's okay that the gameplay doesn't fully line up, but I'm just curious to see how close they will try. But with all that said, those are 5 interesting details and theories I had on the new trailer for Hyrule Warriors Age of Calamity. It's possible that a lot of this is subject to change, especially given that we are getting more info at the end of September, but I'm planning to look as far into it as possible over the next few months. Until then, I will probably be playing a full playthrough of the previous Hyrule Warriors game on my Twitch channel within the coming weeks to get used to the gameplay style, with a full playthrough of the new one when that comes out. So be sure to follow me there for more live action discussions and fun on this topic. But anyways, thank you all so much for watching. If you enjoyed, be sure to leave a like and sub if you haven't already for more Age of Calamity and Breath of the Wild content to follow. Also, a huge shout out to my amazing patrons and YouTube members for supporting the channel. If you would like to help me out here as well, all the info can be found in the description below. Anyways, thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.